So here we're going to take a look at a disc and drum break animation made by the people at Animagraphs. It's a pretty cool demonstration where you can actually see the motion that's occurring in both hydraulic disc and hydraulic drum brakes. So let's start over here with our disc brakes. We can use our scroll wheel to zoom in a little bit and see what's going on. We'll start up at the top. The component you see spinning in here is often known as the brake rotor or brake disc. That's going to be a cast metal component that's going to provide the friction surface for the brake pads to press against. It's going to attach to the wheel hub, and that's what's going to slow your vehicle. If we follow down, we see a tube here, or it's most likely a rubber hose with the brake fluid going to our caliper. The caliper is the hydraulic component on disc brakes, and we can see here that we have a single piston caliper. It houses this single piston, and when pressure is applied or fluid is pressed into that caliper, it's going to cause that caliper to compress. The piston is going to move out. Now, we only have one piston, so on the other side, you can actually see the motion that allows the caliper to slide back across, and that is because this is a floating or sliding caliper. Now, it looks like with the slide pins, it is indeed a floating caliper. I don't see any contact between the caliper housing and the bracket. The caliper bracket is shown in blue here. That is what's going to support the caliper and mount it to the vehicle. It's going to slide and support the components, or allow the caliper to slide, I should say. And we have two brake pads in here. As this caliper compresses, it forces those brake pads against the rotor. That's the friction action. It's going to cause heat and slow down the vehicle. You can see the alternating red and blue of the rotor indicating the heating and cooling down. And we see these blue arrows coming through here. That is indicating airflow through the cooling fins. That is one advantage of disc brakes, that it provides better cooling than drum. It has increased airflow, and they can use a ventilated rotor, which when disc brakes are used in the front axle applications, you almost always see a ventilated rotor, or in heavy duty rear axle applications. Sometimes lighter duty might use a solid rotor that would not be ventilated. Another cool feature of this animation is that we can actually swivel these components every which way to see what's going on. So let's see if we can swivel this. And here you can see, looking from the backside, you can see how that caliper applies and clamps the brake pads against. Now, I do want to call out this rubber seal here around the piston. That is known as the square cut seal. That is what seals the fluid in there, but it has another function in that that square seal deforms every time the brakes are applied, and it is what retracts that piston back the slightest amount, maybe less than an eighth inch, but enough to pull or remove the tension off the brake pads and allow that rotor to spin freely again so it doesn't have excessive wear on the brake pads. So we can rotate that all different angles and see what's happening there. If we move over a little bit, we'll see that we have our parking brakes demonstrated here. Now, it's important that parking brakes use a mechanical connection. The hydraulic system of hydraulic brakes can fail if there's even the slightest leak. We want to provide a secondary braking system with our emergency or parking brakes, so they will use a mechanical linkage, usually a cable. And on disc brakes, this can be incorporated into the caliper, and it was on some older designs where they would actually use a threaded caliper and have the brake cable attached to the back of the caliper and turn the piston, applying the brakes mechanically. Now, from a technician standpoint, that was a pain. It gave this rigid cable that you had to deal with brake service. And when you went to retract those calipers to install new, thicker brake pads, you had to rotate it. You had to spin that or thread it back in. If you did not do that, you would destroy the parking brake portion of the caliper and it would no longer work. It would require a new caliper, which was an expensive component. So modern disc brakes, when they incorporate a parking brake, most likely they do it by using a small set of brake shoes, and they mount inside the rotor into basically a drum that's machined into that rotor, and it's just there for parking brake applications. That lining in many cases is very thin. It normally shouldn't wear out unless somebody is abusing their parking brake or driving with it on. But to get to that, you would have to remove the rotor, and you can see the parking brake components inside here and service those parking brake shoes if needed. We can also see a brake pedal representing our hydraulic or our service brakes being applied from the cab. Let's move over to our drum brakes and see what's happening there. Once again, we'll start up at the top. We have our brake fluid coming in. Now on drum brakes, this is often through a metal line and it goes into the back of our wheel cylinder here, which we'll get to in a moment. Before we get there, you can see they have the anchor pin labeled here. That provides an anchor point, and you can see every time the brakes are released, those return springs pull the brake shoes both back to the anchor pin, pulling them away from the drum, releasing the brakes. The wheel cylinder is what is the hydraulic component in drum brakes and what does the work. You can see that brake fluid is pushed into the wheel cylinder, causing the both sides of it to expand and push out on pins and thereby push out the shoes. The inside that wheel cylinder, you will see a spring. That spring keeps tension on the cups of the wheel cylinder so that there is no leaks that occur when the system is not in operation. And on the outside, they're not labeled, but we have dust boots on the outside of that wheel cylinder to keep dirt out of there. It is important from a service standpoint that you never see brake fluid coming out of the dust boots. If so, you have a leaking wheel cylinder that would need to be serviced or more likely replaced. For the past 10 years, it's been far more economical to purchase and replace a wheel cylinder. They're relatively low cost compared to rebuilding one. The return springs, you have two return springs up at the top here. They are often different sizes and shapes or lengths. Make sure you install them correctly in the correct location. And then we have our brake shoes. Notice there's two brake shoes used as well. The shoe that faces forward is known as the primary brake shoe, and that will often have a little shorter lining than the secondary brake shoe. The primary brake shoe is going to come in contact with the drum and slow it down a little, but it also tries to turn with the drum, and down at the bottom here, it will actually force that secondary brake shoe into application. And you can see that here. So it looks like our primary brake shoe is on the left. And here, when there's brake supply, you can see it shifting with it and forcing that secondary shoe on the right into the brake drum. The secondary shoe is going to have thicker lining and is going to do the majority of the braking. So make sure when you install these brakes, you install the shoes in the correct location. The backing plate labeled down here is going to be what holds and supports all the brake drum components. The wheel cylinder is going to bolt to it. The shoes hold to it with these two retainer pins on either side. The brake drum in this case is transparent, so you can see what's happening. If it wasn't, that's all we would see spinning as a brake drum. We won't be able to see the shoes. The brake drum has to be removed for any type of inspection of the shoes or any type of service. And down at the bottom between the shoes, we have a retaining spring, but we also have an adjuster, often called a star wheel adjuster because of the shape. This is what allows the brakes to be adjusted as they wear. Most vehicles will have an automatic adjuster, which is going to include a few more components than we see here. You'll have an adjusting arm and a spring that pulls on it. And when you brake that vehicle moving in reverse, that adjuster arm will come down and try to turn the star wheel. If it can turn free enough, it will adjust it out. Once it's at the right tension, it's not turning that free and it won't adjust any further until the shoes or lining wear away further. Make sure that star wheel adjuster is free. When you go to service drum brakes, you will often have to remove the brake drum, and technicians can use a brake spoon to back off that self-adjuster. There will often be a hole in the backing plate or possibly in the drum to allow them to turn the self-adjuster and release the brakes. Just like our disc brake animation, we can swivel this one. So let's turn it to the side. You can see some of the action occurring there. Let's see if we can give you a good vantage point to see how these shoes shift. So here we can see we're looking at our primary shoe. As it applies, that shoe shifts down. Okay, you can see it apply, but it actually turns with the drum. Our secondary shoe, as the brakes apply, it's going to turn with the drum as well, but it's forced in both top and bottom. It's forced in at the bottom by the primary shoe and at the top by the wheel cylinder. And that's why it does most of the braking. Hopefully this animation is helpful. If you guys want to check it out, the link is available in the description below. Feel free to try it out, swivel it. Find it a very helpful animation on understanding how disc and drum brakes work.